Let's open our Bibles to the book of Acts, chapter 2. Let me just tell you this also. I had to speak a little bit. I had to speak a little bit so he can get the microphone on. That music will go off in a second. Thank you, David. I had to speak a little bit because he was behind an accident in 459. So can I give you a testimony tonight? Cheryl and I were pulling out to come here. We got on Grants Mill Road. We're going on to 459, and I was merging. So was everybody else. And a truck with a trailer in front of us smashed straight into another truck, which smashed into another truck, and I had to swerve to get around him. When I looked in the rearview mirror, a car was going to hit me from the back, and he went to the side, and I had to swerve this way, and I had to swerve this way, and we missed two accidents. And let me tell you something, God is good. Amen? Amen. So, what will we do without His hand? Amen. The book of Acts, we're on week 9. I have a great acrostic to help you remember what the book of Acts is all about. An acrostic is really a mnemonic, P-N-E-U. It means an aid in memory. Our aids in memory are like ABCs. We learn a little song, A, B, C. Well, this is an acrostic to help you remember Acts. I made it up for you. Here it is. Advancing church through the Spirit. So that's an acrostic. This is what Acts is about. It's advancing the church. The church starts and it's advancing it. We're going to hear things tonight about what's happened and how the church will advance. We'll continue to hear those things throughout the book of Acts. Again, and let's not forget who they are the Acts of. They are the Acts of the Apostles. And so that's what we're going to be studying, the Acts of the Apostles. What did they do after Pentecost? What did they do after the Spirit hit them? What did they do when the church started? How were they proactive in spreading the gospel? This is what the book of Acts is all about. So it has a lot for us tonight as believers in Christ. Remember, the book of Acts is the main thrust of Jesus' desire for reaching the world. Jesus said this. He said that you shall be my witnesses both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and even to the uttermost parts of the earth. That's Acts chapter 1, verse 3. It's a quote from Jesus. So we know that Jerusalem is right here in Israel. We also know that Judea and Samaria are right here. That's a very, very small part of the world. And he says, you'll be my witnesses here, but you'll also be in the rest of the world. In Paul and Peter's time, in the book of Acts time, that's the Mediterranean basin. So we know that there were going to be witnesses. It was a promise from Jesus saying that there were going to be witnesses throughout the whole world. And in Acts, we see that the apostles do just that. They go throughout all the world. And you can see it. We know that in 30 AD, the world was just in Jerusalem. It was given in Jerusalem. By 33 AD, it went to Judea and Samaria, the rest of Israel. And then from 43 to today, till today, it's been going to the ends of the earth. It literally is a fulfilled promise, a prophecy from Christ, that His word has gone to the ends of the earth. Let me remind you that when Jesus lived, there were other people who called themselves Messiah. Matter of fact, some scholars believe that there was about 15 men that lived around Jesus' time that called themselves the Messiah because they were apocalyptic. They were believing that this Messiah was coming. You have the Essenes who believed they called themselves the children of light, and they believed that Messiah was coming in their age. They separated, actually, they were Jews, separated from the temple and went into Qumran in the desert. So Messiahs were there all over the place. You don't hear anything about those other Messiahs. I heard somebody groan when I said 15. You don't know their names. We know names from history that people who claim to be Messiahs. Matter of fact, one of them is actually mentioned in Scripture. They were living at the same time Jesus was. Why didn't you hear of them? Because they were not the Christ. They were not the sons of God. And this is why we can tell you that Jesus, and one of the proofs, His word has gone throughout the entire world. Their words fell on that first century and never went anywhere. And so basically we see Christ talking about the gospel going throughout the world and it actually doing that. You're here because of the fulfilled promise of Christ. Somebody say amen. Acts mainly centers around two of Jesus' apostles. It's pretty powerful. You probably have never seen this before, but it'll really help you understand the book of Acts. Only two of Jesus' apostles does Acts center around. They tell us a lot of things that produce the outreach that Jesus prophesied. They center around Peter, who's a disciple and apostle, and Paul, who's an apostle. This difference between a disciple and an apostle, there were 12 disciples, 12 apostles. Disciple was a first-hand knowledge of Christ. They were there with Him. An apostle was somebody, it's an office. You're called to be an apostle, to plant churches, to bring an outreach. And so we know that these two, Acts revolves both of these personalities. One was an apostle to Jerusalem, Judea, and Samaria. Who is that? Peter was fulfilling the first part of Acts 1:8. He was an apostle to Judea, Jerusalem, Judea, and Samaria. He was the one that was in the center. He stayed in Jerusalem. He prophesied. He preached, that he did Pentecost from the balcony of that upper room. So he's reaching Jerusalem first, then he goes to Samaria and also Judea. Paul, on the other hand, doesn't preach in Jerusalem. He doesn't preach in Samaria. He doesn't preach in Judea. He is the apostle to the rest of the world. So you will see Acts divide right down the middle almost. You will see Peter be mentioned first, and then you'll see the switch over to Paul. So I want you to see that. One was to the Jews. That's why Peter was to the Jews and Paul was to the Gentiles. Peter and Paul will have disagreements in the gospel. You'll read about them in Acts. You'll have disagreements about circumcision because Peter is reaching the Jews and Paul is reaching the pagans, the Gentiles. So without Paul, the church would only have gone as far as Samaria. It would only have gone as far as Israel. Let me give you a timeline of the entire book. It's pretty voluminous, but I'll just go over it quickly with you. You don't have to learn it all. It won't be a test. We know in 30 AD, the ascension happened. 29 AD, Pentecost, Acts 2. 36, stoning of Stephen, Acts chapter 7. 37 AD, Saul's conversion, Acts chapter 9. 37 to 40, Paul in the desert for 3 years, Acts 9. 38 AD, Peter to Cornelius, Acts 10. 41, Paul begins to minister at Antioch. 44, Paul and Barnabas. 51, Jerusalem Council, where Paul's at. 53, Paul in the Mars Hill in Greece, in Athens. 60 to 63 AD, Paul in prison at Caesarea. 62 AD, Paul appeals to Rome. 63 to 67 AD, Paul in prison until his martyrdom. So we know that Paul takes up the second half of the book. Peter takes up the first half. There's a transition coming. Again, let me give you that timeline in another way, maybe a more simplistic way so you can see it, another simple outline. You can see it this way. We know that Acts 1 prepares the apostles. Acts 2 to 12 is the ministry of Peter. Acts 13 to 28 is the ministry of Paul. You do not hear about Peter after Acts chapter 13 to 28. Acts 9 to 2, Christianity is called a way. It's a way of life. It is not a religion. Christianity is not a religion. Christianity is a way of life. It is something you put on. Come on, somebody say amen. I wish I could preach that to every church in the nation. It's not just coming in on a Sunday. It's not coming in on a Wednesday. It's actually coming in on a Thursday, an off night like you are, because you want to practice the way of life and you want to do it once you're out of here also. Somebody say amen to that. But look how Paul will dominate the book as God uses him to literally reach the pagan world with the powerful gospel of Christ. If you look at it, here's what he does. In Acts chapter 13, the evangelism of Cyprus, Paul's address to Poseidon Antioch, the reaction to the gospel of Poseidon Antioch, Iconium, Lystra, Derbe, that's in Turkey today, the Second Jerusalem Council, the word of the Jerusalem Council is spread, Paul and Barnabas split up, the gospel in Philippi, the gospel in Thessalonica and Berea, that's Greece, that Paul in Athens, Greece, Paul in Corinth, Greece, Paul departs from Corinth to Ephesus, again, Turkey, so he's taking this gospel everywhere, and we see what he's doing, he is bringing it all over. So tonight in our study. Well, before I do that, let me show you that the progress and unity in Acts, because we're talking about Peter and Paul, but they have a similar experience. Look what I'm saying. A lame man is healed. We'll see that in Acts chapter 3 with Peter. We'll also see it with Paul in chapter 14. A historical sermon. We already saw it, Peter to the 3,000 in chapter 3. We'll see it with Paul in front of thousands in Acts chapter 13. Brought before religious leaders. Peter has done that in Acts chapter 4. Paul will be done in Acts chapter 22. Miraculous release from prison. Peter will have one in Acts chapter 5. Paul will have one in Acts chapter 16. Encounter with a magician. Peter will have one in Acts chapter 8. Paul will have one in Acts chapter 13. Evangelization of the Gentiles. Peter will actually touch on the Gentiles. Acts chapter 10. Paul will go to Acts chapter 13. Prominent at a Jerusalem council. Peter will chapter 11, he'll have preeminence. Paul will have preeminence in Acts chapter 15. So the comment there, these parallels are intended by the author to demonstrate that Paul, the apostle to the Gentiles, was not an innovator. He didn't do anything first off. His ministry to the Gentiles had precedent in Peter's ministry, as well in the ministries of other Jerusalem, Palestinian-based Jewish Christians. The author shows how every aspect of Paul's ministry in reality only followed in the steps of Peter, the apostle to the Jews, and is seen in the analysis on the next slide, which I just showed you. So we know that Paul is fulfilling what Peter did to the Jews. He's the next step. Just as Jesus fulfilling the Old Testament, we see that Paul is fulfilling what Peter started with the Jews. So God has a progression. He's raising men up for a progression. He's raising them up to continue the gospel. It's pretty powerful when you think about it. There's no other movement on the planet that can last 2,000 years and have major men start those movements out in different areas and coincide with their ministry. So, where are we tonight in our study? I'm glad you asked. The power of the church. This is what we've studied so far. Witness in Jerusalem. Prologue, Acts chapter 1. The appearance of the resurrected Christ. We studied that, Acts 1, 3 to 8. The ascension of Christ, Acts chapter 1, 9 to 11. Anticipation of the Spirit, waiting in the upper room, Acts 1, 12 to 14. The appointment of Matthias, Acts chapter 1, 15 to 26. The filling with the Holy Spirit, Acts chapter 2, verses 1 to 4. Speaking with other tongues, Acts 2, 5 to 13. Peter explains Pentecost, Acts chapter 2, 14 to 41. That was last week. Tonight, practices of the early church will fill out and will finish Acts chapter 2, verses 42 to 47. So Peter just finishes preaching to the masses. He is preaching with fire. 569 word sermon. It hits four major themes. I showed these to you last week. Peter would God send Jesus to mankind. Not only was Jesus sent to them, but many in this crowd has put Jesus to death. Not only sent to them and they crucified him, but he didn't stay dead. He arose from the grave. And Jesus now seated at the right hand of God to rule and to reign. That was Peter's message, a powerful four-point message. He never even knew there were 4 points in it. I pulled him out of there. There's 4 points. He's telling them something. He's giving them a treatise on what it is to be a Christian. Yes, you're guilty. It's the gospel miniature. God sent his son. He was innocent. Yes, you're guilty. You killed him, including me. You killed him, but he didn't stay dead. He rose and he's at the right hand of God. And then he tells them that they can repent. So it's a pretty amazing story. It's the gospel miniature. Now we get to Acts chapter 2, verses 40 and 41, and he says this, and he says, after he preaches, he says, and with many other words did he testify and exhort, saying, save yourselves from this untoward generation. So he made a distinction. It's the same distinction we can make tonight. You are not the same as the world you live in. You're not. And you can't ever be, according to Jesus. You are in the world, but you're not of the world. That doesn't mean you hate them. Them are us before salvation. So let me say amen. Them are us. So you can't hate them. That's who we're sent to. But he tells them that. He says, there's a difference here. You save yourself from this untoward generation. This generation doesn't want to have anything to do with God. Save yourself. First century. Then they that gladly received his word were baptized. And the same day there were added unto them about 3,000 souls. Now, it's very interesting that the word says them that gladly received his word. That means that some there not receive his word. They were the ones that were probably laughing. They were the ones that were probably scorning. But the ones that gladly received his word were baptized. He takes them very close to Jerusalem, outside of Judea, to Bethabara, the same place where John is, the closest part of the Jordan River. And they baptized 3,000. Somebody comes up to me and asked me last week, how did Peter baptize 3,000? He didn't. He had 120 that were with him. Baptized 3,000 people. I promise you it was all day, but I promise you they got them all baptized. Now they baptized them because they were going to go back to their jobs. Now watch, just listen. They were going to go back to their jobs and they're going to get fired. They're going to go back to the Sanhedrin. They're going to be working for the temple and they're going to get fired. They're going to be ostracized from their families because they're doing something brand new. I know what that's like. I was brought up a Roman Catholic. Every single person in my lineage is Roman Catholic before me. No one ever changed their faith. Not one of them. Big families. Basically, I was the only one to change my faith. And I got ostracized by my mother, by my brother, by people around me because I betrayed the Catholic Church. My mother told me I was excommunicated. I said, Mom, what does that mean? I was just young. She says, well, they no longer recognize you. I said, well, that's good because I no longer recognize them. I was young and foolish, but basically I was attacked. So this happened 3,000 people. This is Judea. This is Jerusalem. These are Jews. And they're going someplace against their, seemingly against their heritage. So obviously, and you're going to see this later today, obviously they lose their jobs. The baptism showed that, yes, not only do I believe in my heart, but I want to outwardly profess that I am part of Christ's body. And so basically, publicly, and let me tell you something, the 3,000 there that were being baptized, there were thousands upon thousands that were not that being baptized, that were there as scoffers. And they're taking notice to everybody that's going into that water. Because if they're working for someone, and that person's on the bank, they're fired. If they're part of the Sanhedrin, they're kicked out. If they're part of the priestly caste, they're kicked out. So they're very, very, if their family sees them do it and they don't agree, they are ostracized from their family. How many are getting it? It's going to come into play a little bit later. So the response, 3,000 get baptized and are added to the church of the 120. So we see that this is what happens. Now, the first church of Jerusalem, the number of congregation before Pentecost, how many people were in the church before Pentecost? Zero. None of them, not including any. The number of the church in the day of Pentecost, 3,120. What a growth. 3,120 less than 24 hours after the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. So we pick up the rest of chapter 2 on verses 42 to 47. I want to read them all for you, and then we're going to go and explain them. So it says, and they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine. These are the ones that got baptized. And fellowship, and in breaking of bread, and in prayer. So they stayed with them. They wanted to learn. They wanted to continue in the apostles' doctrine. And fear came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were done by the apostles. So they were being amazed by the power of the signs that were coming. And all that believed were together and had all things in common. We're going to talk about that. They took all of their wealth, and they put it together. Now, we're talking over 3,000 people. Probably 3,500 because it says many are added to the church. Sold their possessions and goods and parted them to all men as every man had need. We're going to talk about that. Does anybody know what that's called? That's socialism. Who said that? Very good. That is socialism. I thought I told you socialism was horrible. I thought I told you that. Socialism is the beginning of communism. So the first church practiced socialism. Just stick that in your brain for a moment. And they continued daily with one accord in the temple, and breaking bread from house to house, did eat with gladness and singleness of heart, praising God and having favor with all people. And the Lord added to the church daily as such should be saved. So this church is growing. It's massively growing. So obviously there's a couple problems here. If socialism was the first, it was the first way the church was, and that's how it was founded, we're going to have to talk about that. Somebody say, you're right. All right. This is the final miracle of the Holy Spirit on that day of Pentecost, the birth of the church. So why do I call it a miracle? Because I know human nature. Next to the transformation of an individual, the second greatest miracle is oneness with each other. We have been transformed. The best of human relationships, apart from the Holy Spirit, are based on barter of mutual needs. Listen real well. On mutual interests, mutual causes, or mutual fears. We don't naturally live in close, harmonious, giving and forgiving relationships with each other. Somebody say, are like, I used to say this to about, I used to tell people in the church this, we're like porcupines on a cold winter's night. You know what porcupines do on a cold winter's night? They get together, they bunch up. Here's why we're like porcupines. We need each other, but we needle each other. Closer we get to each other, the more faults we find. Come on, how many with me? Human nature is depraved. Now I know you think a lot of us are great people, and we are. We're great in Christ. But let me tell you something. We all need transformation. Amen. Come on. How many remember the old you? How many like the old you? How many wouldn't go to dinner with the old you? If I saw my old self, I would not go to dinner. I wouldn't be around it. So we are basically deprived. I say that to people, and they just look at me like I'm strange, because in America, we don't want to think that. We want to think we're all great. We're not. We don't naturally live relationships. You want proof? All right, let me give you some proof. People will question all the good things they hear about you, but they'll believe all the bad without a second thought. That's human nature. Human nature. People will smile at you to your face, but when they're away from you, they may talk about you. I have this rule. If someone talks consistently about someone else in front of me, I know when I'm not with them, they're going to talk about me. It's just a rule. People don't change. They're like lepers. They don't change their spots. If they're talking about somebody and they're talking consistently and they're a total gossip about somebody in a negative way, then I know when they're away from me, they're going to talk about me. So you ought to be able to be safe in my company when you're not there. I have a niece, Stanley. You've known Stanley. His sister, she works for Bloomberg. She's a lawyer, and she came down. She's unsaved, although we've taken to church quite a bit, and I see her coming around quite a bit. She was very liberal. Amazingly, they voted for Trump, which is amazing to me, because we thought we were going to have a firestorm on our hands when they came down. They came to visit. And I listened to her, and she will never talk about anybody. If she hears something about someone, even if it's negative, she'll kind of change the subject, which is admirable. Come on, somebody say amen. So, basically, our nature is not that way. Without the Holy Spirit, people many times can use others or be used by others depending on their dominance, subservient personalities. A lot of people will use you. Sometimes we use people. Come on, somebody give me an amen so I know I'm not alone up here. All right, because you're making me feel awful alone. Some people will only love you as much as they can use you. Their loyalty ends where their benefits stop. I've been a pastor of thousands of people. I've been a pastor of 6,000 people. I can't tell you how many people wanted to be my friend because I was in a position. They all wanted to get close to me. Now, some of them were very legitimate, you could tell. Others were there just because I was in a position. How many understand? I can't tell you how many people wanted to date my daughters or how many people wanted to date my son because he was the son or the daughters of a pastor of a large congregation. How many get what I say? I can't tell you how many times people, if they know you have money, want to be around you. But if you lose your money, they don't want to necessarily be around you anymore. Or if you're famous, they want to know that you're famous so they can get their picture taken with you. But if you're not famous, man, nobody's taking your picture. Nobody's taking pictures with Lance Armstrong anymore. They were all taking pictures of Lance Armstrong until he was proven to be a doper. And then he lost all of his awards. Now nobody takes a picture of Lance Armstrong. Lance Armstrong, they'd shy away. Read it again. Some people only love you as much as they can use you. Their loyalty ends where the benefits stop. Somebody say amen to that. Amen. So there's lots of things that drive people together. Loneliness is one of them. Loneliness drives people into one place, but that doesn't mean they're together. There's a lot of lonely people that get together, but that doesn't mean they're together. You know, I remember preaching at an Alcoholics Anonymous. As a matter of fact, there's a couple people here from one of the groups. I remember preaching that, and something drove them together. Obviously, they needed help from each other, and that's wonderful. But that doesn't mean that they had everything in common. It doesn't mean that they were supporting everybody outside that meeting. Thank God they're supporting everybody inside that meeting. But lots of things drive us. Our fears drive us together. Why do you think Americans went and hit the churches after 9/11? Churches were bludgeoning with people. There were so many people. They were pouring out the signs. They had to put chairs in almost every church because we needed each other. Fear drove us together. Come on, how many are with me? By the way, prosperity many times drives you apart because you get to do your own thing. You get to use your own stuff. And so we are different, you and I, because the Spirit of God has overtaken our lives. Come on, amen. But the tendencies are there. So humans on their own are fundamentally selfish. Let me repeat it. Humans on their own are fundamentally selfish. And they're easily bothered by their own thoughts. Some people, I found this to be true, some people create their own storms, then they get upset when it rains. Now, before you think I'm bashing the whole human nature, trust me, I'm going somewhere with this, okay? I'm just telling you what unsaved, unregenerated man is like. And how many of you know that we have an old man in every one of us? Somebody talks about you, you're not going to feel happy about that, are you? Somebody cheats you out of money, you're not going to feel happy about that. None of us would. So we have to understand that something's overtaking us, and that's where this is going tonight. So, but when Jesus sets us free, I said when Jesus sets us free, we are able to participate in His full purpose for His people. God, Jesus, get you out of hell. It is to get you out of living in hell. Because some of us live in hell while we're on the earth, and then some people go to hell, which is even worse. Just listen. We can become one within. Jesus' longest prayer in the Bible, read it when you go home, is John chapter 17. And he says this, Father, we are one. Make them, his disciples, one as we are one. One in you, one in faith, one in each other. His prayer for us, if Jesus was to come in here tonight and we asked him to pray for us physically, if he was physically to come in here and we asked him to pray for us, his prayer for us would be this, Father, make them one. Make them love each other like one entity. Like I love you and you love me. And like I love them. You with me tonight? When he performs the miracle of his love in us, it's then that a character transformation begins, which makes it possible for us to really love each other unselfishly. Now, I'm not going to tell you my testimony tonight because I get no glory in telling my testimony. But trust me, I was one of the most horrible people on the planet. I didn't like anyone. And if somebody did something to me, I made sure they got hurt somehow down the line. So what can change somebody, a crumb like Mark Correll? Obviously, it's not a religion. It's a relationship. Something happened to me. And just like something happened to you. The church, as it was meant to be, and as we see it in the first century, is made up of those kinds of people. In short, it makes us well, W-E-L-L, in our relationship to others. There should never be such a thing as a church split. That is totally anti-Christian. So listen, you can't leave a church. There's reasons to leave a church. But a church split to go against another body of believers is anti-Christian. Now, you'll probably never hear that spoken of anywhere, so I'm going to tell it to you there. I don't have a church, so I can say it. That first church is our pattern for the church today in 2016. Oh, Pastor Mark, if that's our pattern, then we should be practicing socialism. Well, that's about enough time we have tonight, so I'll see you next week. Acts 2, verses 42 to 47. Listen to what it says. The first thing, the true church, the first thing, they were a worshiping church. We'll get to it. And they continued daily with one accord in the temple, breaking bread from house to house, did eat their meat with gladness and singleness of heart. Here it is, praising God and having favor with all people. They were a worshiping church. This is how you get well. They were a worshiping church. Everybody say they were a worshiping church. The early church was built on prayer and worship. You can't build a congregation without prayer and worship. When we read the book of Acts, the record of the early church's history, we conclude that the believers had miracles happen every single day. They didn't follow signs and wonders. Signs and wonders followed them. An expressive, worshipful church results from sincere praise, not just praising, not coming in and singing the latest songs, sincere praise and sincere communion with the Savior. It's not something you schedule to draw a crowd to. Now, I'm going to be very pointed tonight. I'm thankful for there's Christian artists all over, and thank God they sing Christian songs. It's a little strange to me sometimes to go to a Christian concert, to be real honest with you, because it was never meant to be a concert. It was. Now, I'm not saying you're wrong for going. I've gone to concerts. I'm not saying that. I'm just telling the basic is you don't put on a worship. You worship every day. You worship, and it's a freedom of your speech. You need to freely worship. Not one of us is a better worshiper than another one. We all should be equal worshipers, should we not? Come on. You may have more talent singing, and that's wonderful. People will want to hear you. If you don't have one, you're going to have to worship in your shower. That's okay. But we're all to be equal worshipers. Somebody say amen today. I love that phrase, simplicity of heart, in verse 46. Our hearts, our emotions get so tied up at times that we miss the simplicity of just being in Jesus' presence. That's what worship is, just being in Jesus' presence. Our worship of God must engage our mind. It must also engage the affections, the heart, our emotions, our spirit. That doesn't mean that worship has to necessarily be emotional or involve an outward emotional display to be in the spirit, but it does mean that the heart must be engaged. We show outward excitement and worship to sports, to musicians, to celebrities. It would only seem right that God would deserve more. So I'm not telling you have to jump up and down and go wild in front of you. If somebody does that, that's fine. That's not necessarily worshiping in the Spirit. It could be, but it's not necessarily. How many are following me? Worshiping in the Spirit means you're engaged. Somehow when you get in there, you feel this. How many have ever felt the Spirit of God in a worship service? That's being engaged in the Spirit. How many have not felt it in a worship service? How many have ever been in a worship service you didn't feel the Spirit of God engaging? That's the thing I'm talking about. This is not just being in a certain place. It's you and I being engaged in it. Now, if somebody's in front of you and they're doing something that's distracting you, sometimes it's hard for you to be engaged. You have to overcome that. Somebody say amen. Hard as it is. Listen, I was a pastor of 6,000 people. I was in a congregation where the people were packed from one side to another. Were babies crying? My goodness. At any given time, there were tens of dozens of babies crying. Were people getting up and walking out and doing this and doing that? Yes, they were. And said to me, I'm so sorry for all the distractions. I said, I never saw one single one of them. You know why? Because when I preach, I'm engaged. There's a gear that kicks on. And I'll tell you what, the church could probably be on fire, probably be the last one out. Because I am concentrating on giving that word. That's what this is called, about being engaged in worship. How many are following me tonight? So, our worship must engage the mind and the spirit. Worship is a way of seeing the world in the light of God. When you worship, one person said, worship is the key to the abiding presence of God. You want God in your life? You want Him to abide in you, live in you? Become a worshiper. And that doesn't mean you have to do it the way somebody else does. You can go outside on your deck with a coffee cup and just look up and let God, just feel God. Let Him come in and let Him overwhelm you. You're with me tonight. That's worship. Okay, don't get set by somebody else's way of doing it. True worship opens our hearts to oneness with God. And once you open your heart to oneness with God, He will open your heart to others. How many have ever heard this? The Lord impressed me to help you. I promise you, most of the times that happens is because you've had communication with God, which, by the way, is worship. Secondly, they were an evangelizing church. And the Lord added to the church daily as such should be saved. How do you think He added them? He didn't just plop them down out of the sky. He had people talk to them, the disciples, the 3,000. As we read the accounts of the first church, it becomes clear. Everything they did culminated in evangelism. Proclaiming Christ was never seen as an option. It was never a job handed out to a special committee or a special person. Evangelism happened regularly as the early believers lived their lives. As they did, they aroused not only curiosity but also admiration and earned an audience of unbelievers. In the church today, we actually debate Jesus' command to go out into all the world and make disciples of all men. Some go as far as to say that they're not called to be evangelistic, that they were called to body ministry. Let me give you two words for that. Hogwash. Healthy, well-fed, worshiping believers will reproduce themselves. If you are healthy, well-fed, you will reproduce yourself. When I am glorifying God, when I'm built up as a believer, I want to then go and share my faith. We talk about what is important to us, don't we? Don't we always talk about what is important to us? Get around some people. They'll talk about Auburn football, or they'll talk about Alabama football. I'm not talking a little bit. I'm talking about that's all they talk about. They'll wear the shirts. Their cars will be dressed like them. They'll have little flags going out of them. I mean, you'll go to their house and every light looks like an Auburn or an Alabama light. And you have, I mean, that's all they're consumed with it. How many are with me? I hope that's none of you, but they're consumed with it. It's okay to have a favorite team. It's all right. But listen, if that favorite team takes precedence over your commitment to Christ, then it's an idol. I don't understand why people don't know that. If you give more time, money, and effort and emotion to something that's not Christ, that's an idol. It could be your children. It could be your grandchildren. It could be your career. It could be my ministry. It could be an idol. How many are with me? Do you know why? I'm going to get off the subject here for a moment. Do you know why Adam was cast out of the garden and why he ate the forbidden fruit, which, by the way, was not an apple? Do you know why? Not because he disobeyed God. 2 Timothy tells us that the serpent went to Adam many times and he was not beguiled by the serpent. He didn't believe the lie. Eve's sin was disobedience to God and Adam. Adam's sin was idolatry. How was it idolatry? Because he knew what God said to Eve. He said, the day you eat, you will surely die. Adam did not want Eve to die alone. He loved her. So he went and took of the forbidden fruit so that Eve would not have to die alone. He made Eve a god above God. That's why he fell. So an idol can be anything. Anything you spend more time on than God. I gotta go home now because I'm getting looks. The early believers had to be touched by Jesus. They'd been touched by Jesus. He had forever changed their lives, so much so that they were willing to give their lives for him in everything they did. Evangelism wasn't a planned event. It was a natural outgrowth of a healthy relationship with Christ. The early believers took everyday situations and turned them into opportunities to share the gospel. In the church today, we made evangelism the job of the evangelist. I am officially an evangelist. The IRS looks at me as an evangelist, and boy, do they look at me as an evangelist. The Greek word is euangelizo. It means to announce or show the good news. Now, you tell me with that definition, how many of us are not called to be evangelists? To announce or share the good news. I got some really good news for you too. Yes, there's an office of evangelists. We know that in the church. And yes, there is the specific role of an evangelist. We understand that. But we're all to be evangelists, to share or show the good news. Know how it starts? And this is going to let you all off the hook and put you all on the hook. You ready? You know how evangelism starts? It starts with a smile. Smile on my face doesn't mean my life is perfect. I just appreciate what I have and what God has blessed me with. Your smile invites people. The worst thing you can do in your life is be miserable on your face. That's the worst thing you can do. If you're having a bad day, let me tell you a couple things about people. People are selfish. If you're having a bad day and you want to go tell somebody you're having a bad day, here's what they're thinking. I can't wait until you stop. How many are with me? Because I want to tell you how bad my day is. How many are with me? The best thing you can do is smile. Your smile invites people into your life. They want to know why you're smiling, especially when catastrophe happens to you, especially when something terrible happens to you. If you read in Scripture, every time you hear the word murmur in the Old Testament, it was a negative connotation. The Israelites all murmured, and so God opened the ground up and swallowed some of them. They all murmured, and he sent these little snakes to bite them and kill them. And so murmuring is not biblical. Oh boy, I'm getting myself in hot water tonight. All right. Sometimes your joy is the source of your smile, but sometimes your smile can be the source of your joy. Smile. Pretty simple, isn't it? See, miracle in life every day. That's why you should smile, because every day is a miracle for you. Come on, somebody say amen. You're still with me tonight? Those of you that don't like me have to leave out of that door. The other one's looking over there. And why show it to the world? Why evangelize? Why show it to the world? Well, if you had the cure to cancer, wouldn't you share it? You have the cure to death. Get out there and share it. We don't have the cure to cancer. We have the cure to death. If you die in Christ, you live. Come on, somebody say amen. Wouldn't you want to share that? I mean, that's the whole idea of evangelism. Maybe somebody should ask you, why are you smiling? Number three. I'm going quickly. Number three. They were a learning church. Acts chapter 2, verse 42. And they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship. I'm going to dig myself out of a hole right now. In short, they learned God's word. They got around God. They were teachable, and they put themselves in a place to be taught. This is a to a healthy church, a commitment to preaching and learning God's word. At the time of the first church, this meant listening to the apostles' teaching and reading the scriptures that they had at that point. And by the way, they didn't have as much scripture as you and I have. They had this. Let me show you what they had in scripture. All they had was the Old Testament and this. They did not have Acts. They did not have Galatians, 1st, 2nd Thessalonians, 1st, 2nd Corinthians, Romans. They had none of this. All they had was just this in the Old Testament. But they wanted to hear everything the disciples had to say about it. But also notice the words, they continued steadfastly. Keep in mind, this means not only that the apostles taught faithfully and continually, but that the congregation was faithful to continue in, to learn and grow and keep growing in what was taught. They were attentive. They remind me of you coming on a Thursday night. What's wrong with you? Don't you have enough church on Sunday and Wednesday? You are doing exactly what the first century church did. You are taking another day and you're seeking out teaching. You're seeking out something to learn. You're seeking out something that will enhance your knowledge of Scripture. You're getting around someone who has an office called the evangelist, who has an office to teach, a teacher, and you're getting around him not so you can hear my words, but so you can hear the words of Scripture. You are doing what the first church was called to do. You are getting together on an off night and you're saying, God, I want to hear your word. I want more of your word. What's wrong with you? Actually, I should say, there's a lot right with you because you're doing with you. But how many are with me tonight? So, 2 Timothy tells us this. They remind me of you in Thursday night study, getting all they can out of the word of God. 2 Corinthians tells us this. Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needs not to be ashamed. That's what you're doing tonight. You're studying. You are studying with me. Now, here it comes. Every now and then I have one. It's a Mark Correll theory. I call it a Correllianism. Here it is. You ready? You ready? Wait for it. Wait for it. You ready? A Correllianism. People develop an appetite for what they fed. A church with a steady diet of feel-good sermonettes in place of good theology or solid biblical teaching from Scripture will eventually raise an underfed, weak congregation. And let me tell you something, people would put me to task for that, but that is the truth. And if you teach people faith and doctrine and power from the Spirit, you will have a congregation that is fired up and strong in God. And anything that comes by them, they will be able to handle. Come on, somebody say amen. You want to see it a little bit more? Scripture. It says, we have much to say about this, the disciples are saying, but it's hard to make it clear to you because you no longer try to understand. He's talking about people who don't want to listen. In fact, though by this time you want to be teachers, you need someone to teach you the elementary truths of God's word all over again. You need milk, not solid food. He's saying you have not grown. This could be the indictment to a lot of churches in America today. You've not grown. All you've done is kept milk. You don't want anything else. So that's what you need. Anyone, verse 13, lives on milk, being still an infant, is not acquainted with the teaching about righteousness. But solid food is for the mature, now watch, who by constant use have trained themselves to distinguish good from evil. When you mature in God's word, you have a better understanding of good and evil. That is powerful. You will know the enemy when he's coming at your family. You'll know him when he's coming at you. You will understand it. If you're not geared in God's word, and Sunday morning is just something that's just casual for you, and you don't read your word, or you don't study your word, you don't come to a Bible study, you will not be able to discern good and evil. That's an amazing indictment. Listen, someone who is learning and seeking more of the word will mature at a much greater rate than someone who is not. And Hebrews tells us in these verses that they will actually be much more capable of identifying evil in their lives and around them in their world. Wow. Lastly, number 4. So you have a worshiping church and a loving church. And all who believed were together and had all things in common, here's the stickler, and sold their possessions and goods and divided them among all men as anyone had need. Okay, just out. It's common union. We get our word communion from it. By the way, we also get our word communism from it. Communion from this, it's a government that evolves from socialism. So let me quickly give you the 16 different types of government on planet Earth today. I'm not going to take time on these. I just want to give you a couple highlights. You have a republic, which is what America is, by the way. A government whose authority is based on citizens' votes, which are represented by elected or nominated officials chosen in free elections. It's very close to democracy. Democracy means the rule of the people. The term today refers to a political system in which the people or their elected representatives govern themselves. You have an autocracy, one person. A theocracy, God ruling. That's not happening anywhere except for pagan gods. Technocracy, fascism. You know all about those. what Mussolini's fascist Italy was about. You have something you don't even know, an anarchy, nobody rules, a monarchy, a supreme authority vested in a single or usually hereditary figure, a plutocracy, which is a government ruled by the rich or powerful, oligarchy, which is a form of power structure in which power effectively rests with a fraction of the persona, tyranny, totalitarianism, communism, federation. These are all the governments, 16 different types of governance in the world today. You have these last two are right here, and I'm not really concentrating on these. A junta refers to a group, a coalition that takes control of the state after overthrowing a government, usually in third world nations. A dictatorship, a form of government where the power rests entirely on one person or a group of persons. This rule could be acquired by inheritance or force, and is usually oppressive. So there's a lot of ways man rules himself. Socialism is a real interesting one. How does communism evolve into socialism? Well, we have in the socialistic revolution, all the rulers lose power, wealth, and privilege. All the rulers are taken down. Workers take control of the country to produce things for everyone. No one is exploited. Nothing is made for profit, therefore all people benefit. These ideas spread across the world to create communism. Unfortunately, it's flawed because there's a lot of people who take power to themselves. But socialism is you take from the haves and you give to the have-nots. You spread out everything equally. How many are with me? So it goes to communism. If I could show you it again, and I don't want to read all of it for you, there's a difference between capitalistic economy and a socialist economy. We have privately owned things for ownership. Socialist is state-owned. Competition brings out the best in people. That's us. Cooperation is the best way for people to coexist. Everyone works for his own wealth in capitalism. Everyone works for the wealth which is distributed equal to everyone. Level playing field in capitalism. PSUs, private enterprise, are permitted in few businesses only. Only in situations where law have been broken. Interference, but the government is fully involved in socialism. Employee motivation, highly motivated in capitalism on account of proportional benefits. You can make a lot more money if you're motivated. Rarely motivated as performance is not rewarded. Merit, perception of a better economic growth because of competition. Equal distribution of income results in welfare of all. Demerit, fewer individuals, groups attain powers, rest are exploited. Hard work is not rewarded. Lazy employees also enjoy equal levels of benefits in socialism. So socialism is a really interesting thing. Let me give you one last one. Good old American capitalism rewards success. Free market, privately property ownership, rights protected from the government, by the government. Punishes successes, rewards laziness, redistribute. How many of you see they're just creeping socialism in our, we reward laziness. By the way, whether we benefit from this or not, I'm not giving you a judgment, but unemployment compensation is socialism. Welfare is socialism. You can be someone who collects welfare and doesn't work at all. How many of you understand? You're paying for that. Oh boy, I'm getting two okays. That means everybody doesn't have a job and I'm in trouble right now. All right. Redistribution of wealth, collective ownership, large welfare system, large invasive government. That's what a liberal government does. It gets the government more involved. Everybody's dependent on the government. It's socialism, communism, abolition of private property, confiscation of property rights. Government owns everything, leads to a totalitarian state. Socialism always evolves into communism. So how in the world can this first century church be socialistic? Well, get ready. How many want the answer to that? So how in the world do they, what was that first century church, why was it a, was that first century church a socialistic governing body? Was it a Bernie Sanders movement? Well, yes and no. Yes, they had all things in common. I just read it for you. Yes, they shared all their wealth. Yes, they divided it equally as somebody had a need. That, in the pure form, is socialism. Bernie Sanders would have loved the structure of the first century church, but hold on. I remember reading Acts chapter 2, the end of it, when I was a pastor of a mega congregation. I did some quick figuring one day. 6,000 members, average 3 per household, 2,000 households average at a time for yearly salaries is about $55,000. If we all place just our one-year salaries in common, not our other assets, just our one-year salaries, the yearly income of that church would have been $110 million. $110 million. The tithe would have been $11 million. It was nowhere near that. What about everyone here tonight? How would you feel if I said next Thursday, we're not having service, Thursday after, I just feel that we should take all of our monies, all of our assets, and put it together. We'll bring it all together, we'll put it here, we'll get a group of people to oversee it, a committee, and if you have a need, we will take it up with the committee and we'll divide it severally out to that need. How would you feel if we did that? Some of you would be happy. Much. Some of you would be extremely sad because you earned that. You worked hard for that. You worked and you toiled for that money. And why should you give that out to somebody who hasn't even worked? Look, socialism, listen, socialism and communism doesn't work. I've told it to you several times. It doesn't work. So, the two questions are this. So why was the first century church set up this way? How could it work? And the second question is, how could it work? So let me answer the last question first. How could it work? It worked because it wasn't man-made, and it wasn't man-led. It wasn't an ideology like the government, socialism, or communism. It wasn't a government instilled by man. It was Holy Spirit-led and Holy Spirit-driven. And as we'll later see in the case of Ananias and Sapphira, when they lied about it, they died. These were Christians. Now, secondly, why was it set up this way? Well, now here's where the caveat is. To protect and to provide for the 3,000 and the 120 and those daily who were added to the church who would be ostracized from the Jewish society, who would lose their jobs, who would lose their income, who would be banished from this their unbelieving families, who would be destitute upon their recent conversion. Please note that after the church is established, this practice was done away with. This was only the first century church, only happened in Jerusalem, only happened at that time. We know that Paul would go onto missionary journeys and he would get a tithe of people and he would send just a tithe back to Jerusalem church. He never said, you've got to give everything together and put it all common. This was to establish the church so people didn't starve to death. How many see it? But the amazing thing to me is everybody was willing to do it. They were willing to say, you had rich people in that congregation, you had people who were poor, they were all said, we don't care, we're taking everything we have. And you see the oneness? We're giving everything we have so that we can all share it right now so none of us suffer. Man, if we could be one like that, it would be amazing. The description wasn't intended to describe a socialist utopia. It illustrates just how literally you're called to love one another. The reason the early church could share their possessions was that they were actually living out the second great commandment to love their neighbor as themselves. We said that their unity and love was powerful that all the people thought well of them. Why wouldn't you want to join such a love feast where everyone was cared about and accepted? As a result, their numbers exploded and thousands came to Christ immediately. When we're talking about a loving church, we're talking about people who are connected to one another. I'm closing, but follow this out. In close fellowship and people who serve one another in true ministry, Jesus said in Matthew 19:19, love your neighbor as yourself. What would happen if we truly began to take Jesus at his word and live that way? What would this do to the church? Can you imagine how different things would be if we operated by this principle? You wouldn't need welfare from the government. You wouldn't need unemployment compensation. We take care of ourselves. Come on, somebody say amen. What would it be like if we really were as concerned about others' happiness and problems and disappointments as we are about our own? Our love for one another is one of the greatest witnesses to the world. It backs up everything that we're trying to do and to say to an unbeliever. Remember in Acts, all the believers were as one? The response was a daily adding to their numbers, a daily adding. People came to Jesus because they saw how Christians loved each other. Too often the opposite is true today. So what really was going on in that first century church? Well, here's where I'm going to close and you got to get it. Look at one more time my 4 points. In this way for a reason. And if you're listening to me, I started from the bottom of our text and worked our way up. I said they were a worshiping church, they were an evangelizing church, they were a learning church, and they were a loving church. Anybody see anything? They were well. They were well, worshiping, evangelizing, learning, loving. They were well. God, through the Holy Spirit, was healing the human condition of selfishness through the entity we call the church. Man, if we can need anything in Christianity today, we need to get well again. We need to be worshipers, evangelizing, learning, and loving each other. Here in Acts chapter 2, as it comes to a close, that this chapter really is only the beginning of what's happening on Pentecost. It's what the Lord wants for every Christian congregation. Everything led up to Pentecost, the virgin birth, the master's ministry, the cross, the empty tomb. Without Pentecost, there would have been no church. Somewhere in someone's obscure history, a Galilean carpenter might have been mentioned, or perhaps the record of the visit of the Messiah to planet Earth. But it took Pentecost to perform the miracle of the transformation of the human personality. It transforms our personalities. Pentecost could not have happened without Calvary and the empty tomb, but if it had not happened, we would not have known what Christ did for us. The church is the most powerful entity on earth. It is the thing that can transform the world, but we have to be transformed as individuals first. This is no less than a recreation of the human spirit. When the Holy Spirit sets about the work of recreation, a new creature is made possible. Nothing less is what began at Pentecost. No observable law of human personality was contradicted. A higher law was demonstrated. The human spirit can be enabled by the divine spirit to know unqualified love. That's what we're called to do. That's a very difficult thing for us unless we tap into the spirit. It happens because the attributes of the spirit become the abilities in the human spirit. The character of the divine person, Christ, becomes the characteristics of the human personality. The life Christ lived can become both model and might. When the eternal Logos comes with us and within us, we are freed not just to live our lives for Him, but to live our lives in Him. What happened to Gideon of old in a more manifested and lasting way happens to us. Let me read it to you real quick before I close. But the Spirit of the Lord came upon Gideon, and he blew a trumpet, and Abiezer was gathered after him. He's fighting the Midianites. So we see that the Spirit came upon him. One translation says this, the modern English version. The Spirit of the Lord enveloped Gideon. He blew a ram's horn trumpet, and the Abiezerites assembled behind him. Perhaps the best translation is the original Hebrew. It says this, the Spirit of the Lord clothed Gideon. The Spirit, he wore the Spirit. In the upper room, the Lord, through the Holy Spirit, clothed himself with 120 ready, eager followers. Then he added 3,000 more. And today, right now, he's clothing himself with you and me. And he wants us to clothe ourselves with him. Ephesians says this, let the Spirit renew your thoughts and attitudes. Put on, clothe yourself with your new nature, created to be like God, truly righteous and holy. How many are learning something tonight? The church is here to provide an opportunity for us. It's a wardrobe. The church is a war. It's your closet. It's you to go into your wardrobe and put Christ on. It should help you. Tonight, coming to service should help you put Christ on so you can wear Him out there. And let me tell you something. When you wear Him out there, you'll be well. You'll be well because you'll be worshiping Him. You'll be thankful for what you're feeling. You'll be evangelizing. You'll be loving, and you'll have a desire to learn. You will be well. Be well. It's the Spirit in us. Tonight, the greatest thing I can tell you is this. Mark Correll's changed not because of religion, not because somebody spoke to me, but because I got it. When it was put to me, I got it. I got to take my old clothes off and who I am, and I got to put on Christ. I got the Spirit move me. So, when I'm not in church, and I'm driving down the road, and God's Spirit tells me, you know what, you need to help that person over there, I say, okay, I'll help him. He doesn't tell that to me for everybody. But when he tells me, I help. The Spirit is clothing me. When he says I got to reach out to somebody, or I'll be on the phone and I'll call somebody up that I haven't called up in 3 years, and I'll say, I was thinking about you today and I wanted to call you. I really felt I needed to call you. I didn't tell them the Spirit told me to call him, but the Spirit did. What was happening? The Spirit was clothing me, and he's using my mouth. He's using my arms. He's using my mind. I'm allowing him to take over me. Let me understand what I'm talking about. So tonight I'm going to ask you to stand with me just for a moment. How many learned a little bit about the church tonight? Now, if you want to go to your church, and I don't know what church you go to, whenever you want to go to church, this is a criteria for your church. Does your church that you go to, and you come from a lot of different churches here, does your church that you go for, does it allow you to worship in whatever way you worship? Does it push evangelism, saying to reach out to others? Is it a learning church? Are you hearing the word of God in that church? Are you learning from it? And are you pushed to love each other? That is the only reason a church should exist. That's it. To get you well and to get me well. So next time somebody asks me all the time, Pastor, I'm going to this church, should I leave the church? That's the criteria. It's meeting those needs. If it's not, it's not fulfilling the first century directive. And so I'm just giving you a powerful way to live your life. Listen, I'm now that I've taught it and now that I've preached it, I am actually subject to live it. Too much is given, much is required. So you came tonight and I'm going to ask us all just to concentrate on those four things. Now, by the way, evangelism is very simple. You don't have to go hit over anybody over the head with the Bible. I prefer you didn't, by the way. Just smile to them that your life is great and let them inquire. Let me tell you what happens when somebody smiles. People want to know why you're smiling. They want to know, why are you smiling? Well, you could tell them about God. So let's pray tonight. Father, I thank you tonight. I thank you for who we're supposed to be in you. I pray tonight, Lord God, that your Spirit clothes every one of us. I pray, Lord God, he comes down just like we have on our shirts or our pants, God, that he would come and clothe us every single day, that we would feel the mantle of your Spirit, Lord. Samuel had a mantle, a coat that his mother brought him year by year as he grew in the temple. That coat was a symbol of the Holy Spirit on his life. Lord, I pray tonight that we have a symbolic coat that is given to us from this day forward, that we can wear it every single day. Bless us tonight, Lord God. Thank you for those who have come. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Thank you.